Well, here we are, the final sermon in our three-part series, Why the Youth Are Leaving the Church. This is not a generalization. This is the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Let's start today by turning in your Bibles to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, and we'll look at verse 17 through 28. We know the parable very well, but God has been opening our eyes in these last few weeks. The Bible says this, and when he came to himself, him being the prodigal, he said, "How many servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." Verse 20 says, "And he arose and came to his father, but when he was a great way off," I need everybody to say a great way off. "When he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran." We read through that, but we really don't understand the meaning of that. He ran. You got to understand what's happening in a Middle Eastern culture. He ran. We will come back to that. "And he fell on his neck and he kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be thy son. But the father said to his servant, Bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. And they began to be merry." Now, verse 25, listen. "Now his elder son was in the field, and he came and drew nigh to the house and heard the music and the dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant." Verse 27, "And he said unto him, Thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he has received him safe and sound." Listen to me. Verse 28. "And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him." Let's pray. "Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. If I had dirt in my hands, I couldn't do much, but dirt in your hands, you can form Adam and cause life to spring from him. Loaves and fish in my hand couldn't do much, but loaves and fish in your hand could feed the hungry multitude. Mud in my hand would be a mess, but mud in your hands can give sight to the blind. A nail in my hand wouldn't mean anything, but a nail in your hand has meant everything. So take this sermon that's in my hands that can only speak to ears. Put it in your hands and speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen." Just a review. We started off with sermon one. Sermon one was entitled, "The Parable of the Son That Left." We talked about the simple fact that this parable has been titled "The Parable of the Lost Son," but he's not lost. He's not lost, number one, because the father knows just where he is. In that first sermon, we learned about reasons why our youth are leaving the church. There were seven, maybe eight, that I gave you. Do you remember them? Who remembers some of the reasons why? They polled maybe 90 young Adventists and some of the reasons why they leave the church. Do you remember any of them? What was it, Catherine?
One of them is distraction.
They were who?
Misjudged.
The reasons that they why they say they leave the church, you know, some were very simple. They just moved away. They got a different job. Their parents moved. Other reasons why young people leave the church was a simple fact that maybe they got a job and now they have to wrestle and vacillate with working on the Sabbath. But then there were some stronger reasons why. And one strong reason was they were tired of the hypocrisy that goes on in the church. Another reason, they were sick of the politics that happen in the church. Sometimes we think our young people aren't watching, but they are. Another reason was that the only reason they were coming to church was because their parents were here. And that's why it's important that we try to capture them while they're here. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he may leave the church, but that won't leave him. Another reason why they leave the church, which was very fascinating, it was they felt that the church was unfriendly to people who struggle with sin. Our young people are watching, and here are the reasons that they give as reasons why they leave the church. So in that first sermon, we learned that powerful, uplifting scripture in Isaiah verse 1 and 2. Isaiah 1 and 2, where a lot of us who have lost our kids, who have left, we're beating ourselves over the head saying, maybe if I had been more strict, or maybe if I had been less strict, maybe if I'd kept them in church school, maybe if I had taken them out. I hope you wrote that scripture down, parents, where you understand that in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 2, that even God says, I have reared up my own children, Israel, and they have strayed away. We have the assurance in that first sermon that you've done your best as a parent. And sometimes kids just stray. I hope that lifts the burden of some parents of hearing that. Even God says, I have reared up my own children, and they too have strayed. We also learned that the boy is not lost, he just left, because the father knows exactly where he is. The parable should be changed. The parable should be renamed, not the parable of the lost son, but the parable of the son who just simply left. And then we went to the second sermon in the series, The Far Country Is Not That Far. We read that awesome text in Isaiah 59:1 where God says, is my arm too short to save you? We read that awesome text where we're asking the question, is there anywhere you go? Can you go too far in your life? It is Satan's greatest lie that you have out-sinned God's grace. You've gone too far. We learned in that sermon that no, the far country is not that far, not that far, not too hard for God, but literally, when Jesus tells this parable on a clear day, you can see the far country from where he stood. Many believe that the far country where the prodigal went was the area of the Decapolis, where if the son had decided in the morning that he wanted to go home, that if he walked in the morning, he could make it back by nightfall. This boy was not too far. And you need to understand that about your child, your son, your daughter. Yeah, they have strayed, but they're not that far. God knows where they are. And his arm is not too short to save them. In that second sermon, we realize that when the prodigal decided to come home, no matter how long he had been gone, it wasn't far for him to get back. So we have this story. But the question still remained, and I left that with you all. Are we willing to accept them when they do come back? In Culver City, that's up to you. Because the children will return, and the question is, are we ready to accept them? We should be. But are we ready? And I wondered and I wrestled with the fact, maybe God has not sent our children back because there's stuff we got to get right first. You see, this story is not about lost boys and lost girls and members who leave the church. The story is about how do we treat them when they return? Will we, like the father in this story, embrace the son? Will we, like the father in this story, kiss that boy? Will we, like the father in this story, accept them even though they smell like pig? Let me make it more relevant. Even though they smell like weed, are we still willing to accept them? But then, the Bible says he kisses him. The Bible says he puts a ring on his finger and he puts a robe on him. But then there's this strange text that says the father ran. Why is this even mentioned in the Bible? Do you want to know why he ran? All right. Remind me. I'll tell you at the end of the sermon. Remind me. He did what? If I forget, I want somebody to raise their hand and say, Pastor, tell us about why he ran. He runs to this boy. Are we ready to accept our youth when they come back? Many of you know, or maybe you don't know, that I love art. I'm an amateur art collector. My wife and I, we live actually next door to the LACMA, and I know she's sick of me telling her, let's go look in the museum. I love to just go and see. And so I was reading a book, and it talked about Rembrandt, the artist in the 17th century. He did some art called The Prodigal. Let's put the first one on the screen. Yeah. This is the prodigal here. This doesn't look like the pig pen. No. This is the prodigal while he's out partying. He's got a good time. Got a young lady in his lap, and it looks like he got a cold one there. And it's, life is good. Rembrandt painted this in a fun time in his life. But then there's another one that he did, which was also entitled The Prodigal. Actually, The Return of the Prodigal. This is like one of his most notable works. And this is done at the end of his life. What was the difference? Look at the focus. There's the father, there's the son, here's the elder brother. Pay attention to where the father's hands are and the elder brother's hands are. Look at the onlookers, and very faintly there's a lady standing at the door. Rembrandt is trying to tell us a story. He's trying to paint us a picture. What happened between the first painting and this painting, and why is this painting no more as one of his greatest works? You see, we deal with the prodigal and this picture, and we look at his story. Verse 13, he comes to his father and says, "Father, give me the portion of goods that fall to me." And I told you all that if that had been my father, the parable would have ended right with that verse. I'm not going to come to my dad and say, "Give me nothing." My dad had a philosophy. I brought you in this world. I will take you out. I'll make another one that looks just like you. Police will never know. He said that. He says, "Father, give me this money. Give me this goods. I don't want to wait until you die. Give it to me now." Not only that, even if the father had died, it was the duty in a Middle Eastern culture for the elder brother to then take over the money, and he was responsible for the family. I had a member tell me last Sabbath at fellowship dinner, I'm not going to point her out. She said, "Pastor, why did the dad give him all of that money?" She said, "If he wanted to leave, he can leave, but he would leave broke. He's not getting any of my money." I gave her a quick answer, but then the long answer was like this: God's love allows rejection. God's love allows rejection, and he respects our choice to leave. Hear me. God's love allows rejection, and he respects our choice to leave. God is not going to take anybody kicking and screaming into the kingdom. Heaven's a place for people who want to be there. That's what love is. God's love is so great. God's love is so deep that he's willing to let you have your life if that's what you want. If you want to leave. See, we think of it in terms as how we are in our lives. You know, when somebody want to leave, you know how it is. You break up with somebody. You ain't going to find nobody like me. Never. But true love says, "I love you enough to let you go." God's love allows the choice for us to leave. And that's why the father, not my dad, I know not your dad, but God says, "I'll give you the money and I'll let you leave. If you don't want to be with me, I will free you. I will let you leave." And by verse 17, the Bible says, "And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many servants of my father have bread enough to eat and to spare, and I perish with hunger?'" We can put verse 17 on. "I perish with hunger." He comes to himself. This is not some self-revelation. This is not anything good. The spirit of prophecy says that he was prompted by the Holy Spirit. You cannot find repentance on your own. If you find repentance in your heart, it is only because the Holy Spirit is working on you. And when we understand that the Holy Spirit was the reason that he comes to himself, we can rejoice, because that means the Holy Spirit visits us in our pig pen. He visits us in those places. He visits us in the bar. He visits us in the red light districts of life. He visits them in the pig pen, but the question still remains, are we a church? When they return, will we accept them? He realizes to himself that I want to be out of this situation and I want to be back in the Father's house in verse 17. I will arise, verse 18, go to my father, and I will say to him, I've sinned against heaven, and I've sinned before thee. Now, there's something in this story that we should all relate with, and that is, it's always good to go home. You know what it's like going back home to Panama. Robert, going back to Nicaragua. Going back to El Salvador, there's something about going home. You love it. You long for it. I remember I was in the Philippines for 10 days. The shower from my hotel, this was the head to the shower of the hotel. It was this tall. The seats, everything was built for people 5'5", 5'6". Yeah. They had no place for me to sit. And I was so, I love it. Let me say, I don't want to offend any Filipinos that are here. I love my time there, but I was ready to go home. I wanted a shower I could fit in. I was tired of eating rice. You know, the Filipinos, they eat rice for every meal. I got a witness in the back. Breakfast, lunch, midnight snack, it was rice. Rice. I was so sick of rice. When I got to LAX, I didn't look. If I'd seen Jerry Rice, I mean Condoleezza Rice, I don't want no rice. I'm sick of rice. I got home and went into all the Uncle Ben's. Yvonne, throw it away. I don't want any. All of this rice. Get it out of here. Jasmine rice. I don't want none of it. There's something we can relate about going home, even if it means just a long day at work. There's something about going home. Can you imagine this boy's got mud under his fingers and he's been eating corn that's been chewed on by pigs? Say what you will about that boy. He smells like pig. But he's no longer in the pig pen. He is going home. If the story ended here, it would be great, but it continues because verse 19 said, I'm no more worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Verse 20 says, and he arose and came to his father, but when he was a great way off. When they come back, there'll be a great way off. When they come back, they may have some scars from some stuff that they've done. They may have picked up some habits out in the far country. But your job is to accept them. Yes. He was a great way off. The Bible simply says this. He was a great way off. His father, what's that next word? I heard one person. He was a great way off. His father what? Not just saw him. This wasn't happenstance. He didn't just walk by a window and happen to see the silhouette of his son. You got to understand the love that this father has. He saw him, but the meaning is he was looking for him. Every day. He sat on the porch. He lost sleep. Because he was looking for that boy. He lost his appetite. Because the only thing that the father had on his mind was seeing that boy emerge on the hill crest. Are we prepared to see them come back? It's one thing to say, yes, Pastor, we will accept our kids when they come back, but it's another to do what the Father does. Here is the manual. He saw him, not just saw him, but he's literally looking for him. When he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. That's an area. That's one of the items that the young people mentioned as a reason why they leave. We don't have compassion. I told you I had a conversation with a guy who was an Adventist. He knew about Adventism. He knew about the Sabbath. He knew that if you want to debate prophecy, you're going to lose if you debate a Seventh-day Adventist. I was so proud that he knew so much about my church. And then he said this to me, they're just not known as being loving people. And as a Seventh-day Adventist minister, I'm four generations. My great-grandmother became a Seventh-day Adventist and started a church in her home. Couldn't debate him. Because what he said was absolutely true. I'm going to say something. Tell the conference. I don't care. I don't want people to know us for the Sabbath or for prophecy. I'd rather people know us by our love. That's what Jesus told his disciples. Let men know that you are my disciples, not by your Sabbath keeping, not by your vegan lifestyle, not by the simple fact that you can quote scripture, but that you have love one for another. Yes. Do they see our love? If we're going to get these kids to come back, if we're going to make them see that this is the place that belongs to them, they need to know that they are loved. He had compassion. And then he did what? He ran. You guys want to hear what it means for the father to run? I heard one person say yes. I'm going to tell you, but not yet. He's a great way off. He saw him. He has compassion on him. If only the story ended at verse 20, but the story continues, and it says in verse 21, and the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned and unto heaven and in thy sight, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servant, bring forth the best robe and put it on him and put a ring on his finger, on his hand, and shoes on his feet. And then in verse 23, he says this. Verse 23, he says, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it and let us eat and be merry. Sorry for you vegetarians. That there were no chocolates. There was no veggie links. It was beef. Kill the fatted calf. When I read this in the Greek, it brought tears to my eyes. Because in the Greek it says this, and bring hither the calf we've been fattening up for this very occasion. Did you hear what I said? Bring forth the fatted calf we've been fattening up for this very occasion. There's one thing to want your kids to come back, but there's another to prepare for them to come back. Make them known that they are missed and that they are loved and they're a part of this church, this community. Yes. We have been purposely fattening up this calf for this very occasion. The father never gave up on his son. And don't you ever give up on your children. Just think how many of us are here today because mom and dad didn't give up on us. They kept praying. They kept getting on their knees early in the morning and late at night, praying you through your situation. Bring the fatted calf. We've been fattening up for this very occasion. Verse 24. For this, look at the words. Look at his words. For this, my son. There's ownership. He's lost, but he's still mine. Come on, somebody. He smells like pigs, but he's still mine. He's been out there doing God knows what, but he's still mine. This, my son, was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now, buckle up. Verse 25 says, now his elder brother, the elder son, this boy was in the field, and he came near and drew nigh to the house. He heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants, verse 26, and asked what these things meant. He says to him, thy brother has come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him safe and sound. Verse 28 says, and he was angry. The brother's home, the father's rejoicing, the family is rejoicing, but the elder brother is angry, and he would not go in. This elder brother in this story represents the church. It's a hard lesson. You are the elder brother. You are the one who won't go in. Remember, this whole story was birthed because the scribes and the Pharisees are upset with Jesus because he receives sinners and he eats with them. This story is not about people leaving the church. It's about how the church is going to accept them when they come back. Rembrandt's picture is moving, because you saw the first one where he's partying up. He's got a lady on his lap, and he's got all the great things. See, Rembrandt painted that picture during a time in his life when everything was going well. He paints this picture when he had more money, when he didn't have time for God. He had actually separated from the church, and things were fine. And as a matter of fact, this is a self-portrait of Rembrandt. That's him. Kind of goofy, yeah. This is him. This is him. This is Rembrandt's face here. But when he paints the other picture, the return of the prodigal, his wife has died. He's lost a lot of his possessions. And the party's over. And he decides to paint himself again. But this time, this is him. We don't see his face. It's buried in the Father. We don't see the scars, but we can see that he's got one shoe on and one shoe off. There was something so important that you got to understand. Look at the father's hands and look at the elder brother's hands. And the question I have for this church, will we wrap our arms around them, or we wrap our arms in judgment around ourselves? There's only two responses when they come back. Will you wrap your arms around them, or will you wrap your arms around yourself in judgment? This is a mirror reflection of how we are as a church, and we've got to do better. I said we've got to do better. Rembrandt does something very special. If you look at this hand, it's It's a lot skinnier than this hand. This hand is very manly, but this hand almost seems feminine and very soft. And he did that on purpose. He did that to show that in the Father's love, you've got the firmness of a father, but you've also got the compassion of a mother. That's what we need to do when we embrace them. Yes, there's times where we need to be firm. Yes, there's times where we're disciplined, but you also got to be able to comfort them. So he has one feminine hand and one strong hand to show that when you come to the Father, he is everything that you need. Will you put your hands around him? Or you put your hands around yourself in judgment, self-righteousness? Here is a story about us. Here is a story about how we treat those who struggle with sin. Here is the story about a son coming home and the church hadn't embraced him. The church is not rejoicing. That's our only job, is to rejoice when those come home. But Pastor, you didn't explain why he ran. See, we just read over that. We just think, okay, he ran. I understand that he ran. And he arose and he came to his father, but when he was a great way off, he saw him, he's looking. He had compassion on him and he ran and he fell on his neck and he kissed him. You gotta understand, in the Middle Eastern culture, when you leave, now 4 years ago I preached this portion to you, but I've learned more since then. In a Middle Eastern culture, if you embarrassed your father, if you embarrassed your family, they were a community. They shared their wealth, they put their money together, they built their community. If you dare embarrass your father, take good Jewish money and waste it in a far country with the Gentiles, there was a ceremony called kezeza. You got to understand, those Middle Eastern people are hearing this story. This boy tells the father, you could die. You should die. Give me your money. I'll do what I want. Goes to a far country. He wastes the money. If you dare did something like that, you were not permitted to come back to the house. You were not permitted to come to this community ever again. So the kezeza ceremony was the men in the church, the men in the community would take a clay pot. They would stand at the gate and they would take this clay pot and they break it. Your relationship with your father, your relationship with this community as broken as this pot. So I learned that when they broke the pot, the father was not allowed to be present. Are you listening to me? The father was not allowed to be present. He couldn't be there. Only the men of the community. He had to sit home knowing that at the gate, the men of the community were breaking a pot, telling him, go back to where you came. You're not welcome here. You're dishonored. Your father cannot help you. And your relationship with your father in this community is broken. Then I read this. It was possible that if the mother was there, she could come and plead with them. If the mom was there, she could ask permission to come and plead for her son. So you gotta understand, when, when Middle Eastern culture are hearing these words, that the father sees him a far way off, and he takes off with his robe and he starts running. Maybe there was no female in the house, but it doesn't matter. The father was not going to let them do that to his son. He loved him too much. He breaks all the laws when he runs after that boy. He will not let them do this to him. Do you understand the father's love? Can you see the father's love? Do you know what it means now to accept them when they come back? Smelling like pigs, smelling like alcohol, smelling like weed. Run for them. Been gone from the church 4 years, 5, 10 years. Run for them. Because the Father, he runs for you. Listen to the words of this song, Brooke.
Some pointless road to nowhere. for grace. Forever running, but losing the race. Worry not for grace.
This father, he takes the embarrassment, he takes the shame. He shames himself before the community gets to shame him. Why would the father do something like that? And here's the answer. He had nothing to lose, because he had already lost it all in that boy. He had already lost it all in that child, that son, that daughter that was out there. I'll take the shame so the boy can come back home. Some of you have been embarrassed what your kids have been doing, but I'm so glad there's this story in Luke chapter 15. Do whatever it takes to make sure they're back. And they're safe. Yes. And that they know that they're loved. Whatever it takes. I'll take the embarrassment. I'll take the shame. Doesn't matter, because they're safe home. I've got an appeal. You stop praying for them. You've given up. But I need you to repent and still believe. Keep praying. Keep loving them. They're special to God. They're special to this church. They're still mine. Even though they've gone far, far away, they're still mine. Would you do that? Would you do that? Will you keep praying for them? Will you keep believing that they'll come back? Just make sure that you're watching, that you have compassion, and you're willing to run.
Pastor, my wife and I, we have 3 girls and 1 boy.
Yes.
They grew up in this church.
And I want to meet them.
You know, and my wife and I, we are praying. We waste night rest, you know. We worry about them.
Yes.
And we are like that father.
Yes.
Looking, waiting, hoping.
Yes.
So this message, Pastor, I and my wife, we are waiting.
Yes.
For our children.
And you're willing to run.
Oh, yes.
You yes. have the Father's heart.
Yes.
They're
Thank
coming
you,
back.
Jesus.
They're coming back. God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you. Keep praying. Keep praying. They're coming. The far country's not that far. God knows where they are, and His Holy Spirit can reach them where they are. My second appeal. You're the one that needs to come home. You've been wandering far too long. And you need to come down here. And I just want to pray that you'll come back, and you'll come back to stay. If that's you, don't just wipe tears. Come down. Come down. I want to pray for you. I'm the one. I don't want them to break a clay pot. I don't want it to be too late. You want to come? Come. I just want to pray with you. I've been gone too far. I've been gone too long. And I long to be home with the Father. That's you. Come. Come. Come, come. I see you wiping tears. Come, come, come. Just come sit down here. If you're in the balcony, come. Come. I've wondered if the Father will accept me. I've wondered what He'll say. Don't worry about that. He loves you more than you know. Come, come. Just sit down here. First person has moved already. Come, come. You're still there. Come. 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 Just have a seat. God bless you. Come. Sing a little louder. Come, come, come. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming. Yes.
With my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go.
Yes, come, come, come.
The battles I would
face. Come. Yes, come sit.
Forever running, but losing.
I've been running, I'm losing this race. And
worry not for
I long to be home with the Father. Come on.
Worry not for grace.
Come on. Come.
I can tell you where I'd be. Wandering down.
All he has for you is compassion and love.
With my salvation up.
Not concerned with
me. And I know
your pastor's not concerned with any of it.
Would go.
All that matters is that you're back.
Battles I would face. Forever running, but losing the race.
He has nothing to lose. Because he's already lost everything when he lost you. Even as I am praying, if it's your desire to be down here, you can still move. The prodigal returns. Thank God. The Father accepts. Thank God. Praise God. And as this church, we will not be like the elder brother. We will not be like that elder son. We too will wrap our arms around the Father, who's wrapping his arms around the Son. Help them to come back to a different church, a loving church. Help them to understand that salvation is not for the righteous, it's for those that need grace. Salvation is for those who need grace. Let them find it in this church. Let them find it in the faces of the people who are here. Help us to accept the return of the prodigal. And remembering that we too, at some point in our lives, we were far from God. We were far from the Father's house, but we were never far from the Father's heart. He loved and he cared for us. And those who have come down now, some for the strength to continue to keep praying for their kids. Some who just long to be in the Father's arms. Seal the decisions that are made today. If somebody needs more Bible study, if somebody needs rebaptism or baptism, they can let us know. And we will facilitate whatever they need. We thank you for what's happened today and for the church you'll make us in the future. Let God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you.
God bless you. For grace.